Well, hello there, my garden reflection friends. Thank you so much for joining me for this devotion. As you can see, I'm sitting here next to my beautiful corn garden, and I want to focus on the corn garden in this devotion. Now, as I was walking around looking at my corn garden and the other gardens here, I'm just amazed how much comes from just a little bit of seeds. And I've got a bag here, silver queen corn. That's what the squirrels grow. And it's just about a half a pound. And did you know it only takes not even a whole bag like this to plant a whole big garden of corn? And we've had our first pickings the other day, and we must have picked about 150 ears, and we still, and my husband Donald said that it's about, we picked about 25% of what we're going to, what he thinks we're going to get out of the garden. So boy, we still got a lot more ears to go, all from less than half a pound of seeds. And you can see I can fit that right in my hand. And so I got to thinking about how God uses little things. He uses just a little, what he can do with just a little bit. If we allow him to use that in our lives, and he can make something great out of just something little to glorify him. And so that's the focus on my devotion in this video. So in thinking about that, I'm going to begin by going to 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 31. Whether therefore you eat or drink, or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. And that kind of reminds me of the verse from Ecclesiastes 9:10, where it says, whatsoever thy hand findeth to do, do it with all thy might. So let's think about how we can use what's in our hands to do it for the glory of God, to use it for the glory of God, or allow God to use it to bring about, to draw people closer to him, to come to know him. And so let's think about some examples from the Bible to help us to better relate to this. I wanted to bring you to Exodus chapter 4, and we're going to read a little bit about Moses and what he had in his hand that God used in a great way. Moses, Exodus chapter 4, verses 1 through 5. And Moses is having a conversation with God here about leading the Israelites out of Egypt to the promised land. And this is the part of the conversation that they had. And Moses answered and said, but behold, they will not believe me, nor hearken unto my voice, for they will say, the Lord hath not appeared unto thee. And the Lord said unto him, what is that in thine hand? I love that, how he asked that question. What is that in thine hand, Moses? And he said, a rod. And he said, cast it on the ground. And he cast it on the ground, and it became a serpent. And Moses fled from before it. And the Lord said unto Moses, put forth thine hand, and take it by the tail. And he put forth his hand and caught it, and it became a rod in his hand. And the purpose of this was found in verse 5, that they may believe that the Lord God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, hath appeared unto thee. And so that's what the glory of God is. God is showing himself, revealing himself, magnifying himself. And the purpose of this was to help the Israelites and others to believe that God was with them, that God's presence was there. All right, so another example I want to share with you is that of David and Goliath. And we all know what was in David's hand when he fought the giant Goliath, right? A stone. And so let's read about that account that in the Bible in 1 Samuel 17, in verse 46 to 49. And we think we all know the story of how Goliath was the enemy of God's people, and David was greatly used of God to defeat this enemy, Goliath. And so this is the conversation David was having with Goliath in verse 46. It's pretty strong words. "This day will the Lord deliver thee from mine hand, and I will smite thee, and take thine head from thee, and I will get the carcasses of the host of the Philistines this day into the fowls of the air, unto the fowls of the air, and to the beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands." And it came to pass, when the Philistine arose and came and drew nigh to meet David, that David hasted and ran toward the enemy to meet the Philistine. And David put his hand in his bag and took thence a stone and slung it, and smote the Philistine in his forehead, that the stone sunk into his forehead, and he fell upon his face on the earth. So God used that stone in a mighty way, didn't he? He guided that stone right in the place on Goliath's forehead that would instantly kill him and defeat this enemy of God. And so God showed himself real through what was in David's hand, a stone, through a little stone. And so I think about, in thinking about David, I automatically think about that little town of Bethlehem where David was from. A little town. You know, the Bible talks about the little town of Bethlehem. The Bible tells us about something great that was going to come out of that little town. So let's go to Micah chapter 5. Micah chapter 5. We'll read about the prophecy of the Messiah, Jesus Christ, coming out of the town of Bethlehem. And let's go to verse 2. "But thou, Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall come forth unto me that is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from old, from everlasting." And so we're talking about Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, who came from, who God chose to come out of the little town of Bethlehem. And in my study, I thought it was interesting that Ephrata actually means fruitful. And so when I think about Jesus coming out of the town of Bethlehem, I think, well, how was he fruitful? Well, the Bible actually says that he is the first fruits of those that slept or died in the Lord. And I'm going to read that to you. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 20. "But now is Christ risen from the dead, and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive, but every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterward they that are Christ at his coming." So like we just had our first picking here of corn. I call it first picking. And in Bible days it would have been called first fruits. My first fruits. So Jesus was the first to consider Jesus the first fruits of the resurrection, and because he died for our sins, he was buried, and he rose again to be our Savior. And for those who believe on him, we can also rise again, be resurrected from the dead. And I think about being fruitful, you know, and what Jesus can do with what's in his hand. And so in thinking about that, let's go to John chapter 10, verse 28. It's one of my favorite verses. So we talked about what was in Moses' hand. We talked about what was in David's hand. In the little town of Bethlehem, what came out of that? Jesus. And now let's think about what's in Jesus' hands. In John chapter 10 and verse 28. Jesus is talking here. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. He's talking about those of us who believe on Jesus, who've accepted his free gift of salvation. And so we are in Jesus' hands. No man can pluck us out of his hands. And so in thinking about the great things God does with small things, what can God do with me? I'm in his hands. I'm in God's hands. What can God do with me? You know, the Bible does talk about the fruits of the Spirit. And when we accept Christ as our Savior, we have the Holy Spirit living in us. And we can display the fruits of the Spirit. And let's go to Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. To see what fruits of the Spirit we can produce. And in thinking about being fruitful here, Galatians 5, 22 through 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And let's also go to 2 Corinthians 4, verses 4 through 6. It says here, for God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, hath shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. It was talking about us having the light of Jesus in our hearts. And when we shine that light for others to see, we can help others to come to the knowledge of the glory of God through Jesus Christ. We can show God to others by the way we live, by displaying the fruits of the Spirit, that they will see Jesus living in us, and that it will help them, others, to come to know Jesus as well. But God, so how can we, God, use us though? What needs to happen here? Well, the last thing I want to look at is how God wants us to think of us as being small, as being nothing, not doing anything of ourselves. Just like David said, the battle is the Lord's. It's nothing we can do. We need to do things through his power, right? So let's go to Micah chapter 6 and verse 8. He hath showed thee, O man, what is good. And what doth the Lord require of thee, but to do justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God. And the key there is to walk humbly with God. The Bible says in Proverbs 3, 5 through 6, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not into your own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. So we could think of us as the seeds, and God will put us in the right paths as he puts us in just the right place for us to be the most fruitful that we can be as we just surrender our lives to him humbly. Lastly, I'd like to read Psalms 149, and we'll begin with verse 4. Psalms chapter 149. For the Lord taketh pleasure in his people. He will beautify the meek with salvation. Let the saints be joyful in glory. Let them sing aloud upon their beds. Let the high praises of God be in their mouth, and a two-edged sword in their hand. And so the Bible refers to the two-edged sword, I believe it's in Hebrews, as the Word of God. And that's what is in our hands. So we're in Jesus's hands, and we have His Word in our hands. And this is what we can use to help guide us, to help us to know God more and understand His ways, and to be the most fruitful that we can be, and to help others as well to come to know God, and to see to see God for who He, the wonderful great God for who He is, by the Holy Spirit revealing God to them and us as we get to know God's Word better. So I just thought that was neat that it said the sword of the Spirit, the sword was in their hands. It's getting dark now, it's kind of hard to see. But so yeah, we have this in our hands. What are we going to do with God's Word? So it's something to think about. At how God can use the little things in to greatly glorify Him. He wants us to be at that place, that humble place, to think less of ourselves, to make ourselves small, so that we can magnify the Lord. And in thinking about the beautiful gardens, how beautiful they are. Bible says He will beautify the meek in salvation. So these are just really neat applications that I've been meditating on, and I hope that it was an encouragement to you as you go through your Christian lives and try to be just to do everything you do for the glory of God. And it's something that we can use the Word of God to help us. We can just be mindful of that every day and humble ourselves, and God can use us in great ways when we do that. All right, thank you so much for joining me. I hope you've enjoyed this video, and I hope to see you soon as I gather some more insight as I work in my garden. So, all right, have a good day, everyone, and y'all be blessed. All right, bye-bye.